deciding to help them to write about or talk about or perform their work. And it's transformative both for them and for us as faculty. It's in these moments that we really hone our own skills as both teachers and scholars. And so it's a high impact and meaningful practice for us and for students. And so I really do want to spend just a minute talking about why we've taken this day out. It's a day on, not a day off, but why we've taken this day out of the semester to not hold classes and to focus on research. And so I really just want to talk to the students in the audience, although faculty, obviously, you can listen in. First, students, I think it's really important to congratulate yourselves on all the hard work you've done on your research project. And I really want to thank you for taking the time to do so. It often involves going beyond what you're doing in the classroom, hours of work outside of class. And really, one of the reasons we take this day is because you deserve a bigger audience than just your professor or members of your class. The work that you're doing has reach and stretch beyond the confines of the classroom. And so it's important to do that. And this is related to the second reason, which is that sharing and disseminating your research is one of the important activities of what we do as scholars and researchers. So we are teachers as faculty, but we are also scholars and researchers. And what we do is create knowledge. We share and disseminate that knowledge with others. And it's through the interaction with other scholars that we really help to create knowledge and change what we know. And that's super important. But also it's related to really what universities are about. Universities create knowledge, and they are places where inquiry, critique, and civil discourse are cultivated and valued. We have these scholarly conversations in a civil way, most often, although faculty, we have stories when it's been uncivil at times. And so it's important to understand that the university is really a unique place in our society. And it's a reason why people from all over the world come to study at American universities. In the words of writer and literary scholar Louis Menand, the university is a place, quote, to serve the public culture by asking questions that the public doesn't want to ask, investigating subjects it cannot or will not investigate, and accommodating voices it fails and refuses to accommodate. And so the university, all universities are unique places in our society, and it's important that we treasure that and celebrate that, and that's really what this day is for, is celebrating your work and celebrating what it is that we do here at Longwood. And finally, then, on a practical note, and you'll hear this again and again today, I'm sure, is that it's important to keep in mind that the research skills that you're acquiring are skills that employers seek. And so as you go out, many of you are juniors and seniors, as you begin to apply for jobs or you apply for graduate school, it's important that you are able to talk about those skills that you've acquired through this work. Communication skills, problem-solving skills, the ability to ask good questions and find out how to answer them, flexible and elastic thinking, being able to look at problems from multiple perspectives and try and understand them better. The ability to collaborate in working groups. Those are all kinds of soft skills, as they're called, that employers desperately need and want today. And through this work, you've acquired them. So congratulations to all of you and the work that you've done today. Have fun today, and I'm really excited to really enjoy the day with you. So thank you.
Good morning. First, I would like to thank our intrepid Dean of the Library, Fred for setting up the tables and getting all the presentations set up this morning, so thank you. So I'm happy to welcome you here to the library and to the start of the Spring Symposium. So Dr. Sarah Tanner Anderson has agreed to give our opening remarks this morning, and we're very happy to have her. She is a double alum of Longwood. She has her bachelor's degree in English and her master's degree in English education and writing, both from Longwood in 2002 and 2007. After after Longwood, she earned a Doctor of Education from George Washington University in 2014 in Educational Administration and Policy Studies. So Dr. Tanner Anderson has had an interesting and exciting career in education. She's a member of local, state, and national professional organizations. She's presented at professional conferences, conducted workshops centered around literacy, leadership, and engagement. She serves as the Higher Education Representative for Women Education Leaders of Virginia and a Region 8 Representative for Leaning Forward Virginia. She's had quite a wide range of experience in K-12 education, so she's been a teacher, a coach, a club sponsor, a department chair, a grade level chair, and an assistant principal and a principal. So she's got a really, really exciting career in public education. And then in the fall of 2017, she joined the faculty at Longwood as an assistant professor and program coordinator for educational leadership. And currently she is in the process of redeveloping the educational leadership master's program. So we're very happy to have her give us our opening remarks and kick off the day.
Well, with an introduction like that, I feel like I could just literally mic drop. But thank you so much. And I'm excited to be here today to chat with you a bit about my journey. I'm going to try to navigate both a microphone and a clicker, so you will get to see how one side of my body is purely decorative and the other is more functional. But I did want to share just a little bit more beyond my introduction with you as I kick off the Spring Symposium this year. I thought it might be interesting for you all to know that I am a wife to Peyton Anderson, who is also a Longwood alum. We met here at Spring Weekend in 2002. We have a young son, William, who is 4, and whether he knows it or not, he is a Longwood legacy. He will be joining Longwood at some point in his academic career. And also, just to let you know that I am a learner. I am a teacher. I am a leader. My mother will tell you that from my birth that I've been strong-willed, a leader from the start, and I'm excited to share with you a bit about my journey in educational leadership and in research. So what I have today for you are just a couple of illustrations, so I hope that you can see them, and if you cannot, I'll still try to articulate what the slides say. Mostly they're just visuals that I wanted to share with you. But to frame my story, I really want you to consider research in this way. I believe research is a process, and I believe that it's a process that has helped me to cultivate a love for learning and sharing that learning with others. And a lot like gardening, you have to prepare your soil, you plant your seeds, you cross your fingers and hope that they take root, you cross your toes and hope that they are fruitful, and then you dance like a maniac when you are able to harvest that fruit, or at least that's been my experience. So what I will do today to take you through my very brief journey through about 15 minutes of sharing out is to share a little bit about my development as a researcher. And first started in preparing the soil. So I was an inquisitive child, and I'd like to share with you a little story about the blossoming of my creative inquiry. When I was a child, about 4 or 5 years old, my mother told me to sit on the couch and watch her from the window as she stepped outside to feed the animals. Now, my mother could see me from the window, and so she said, "Sarah, I'm watching you. I will be right back in." I knew I had a matter of minutes if I was going to conduct and analyze some research, and so I watched and double watched and waited for her to turn her back. And in a matter of minutes, I disassembled her wooden birdcage. I thought I wanted to know what it looked like for the birdcage to be held together with these tiny little bars that looked no bigger than toothpicks. And so I disassembled the birdcage. My mom, not seeing me from the window in great haste, came, you know, bolting back into the house. And all she could see were just feathers and chaos, just a tornado storm of chaos. And I remember in those moments how much I learned, both about bird cages and about, you know, birds in flight and distress, and that feathers detach easily, and that claws are very sharp, and that my mom, in fact, is a superhero. But in those few moments, I learned quite a lot from my research. So I would say, honestly, that research begets unparalleled understanding of the world and your place in it. Never stop exploring and keep searching for that answer to the question, why? For me, I couldn't ever be satisfied with the answer, just because, although my mother would give it to me all the time because I said so, just because. Oh my gosh, dear, I let it go. But I could not be satisfied with that. And so for the sake of time, I'll just say there were many, many stories that centered around my inquisitive childhood. It continued through high school, and I remember when I walked across the stage when I graduated from high school, I wondered if the path that I had chosen to take to come to sunny Farmville, Virginia, and continue on the crazy train of education would be right for me. I wanted, or rather I needed something more, and I didn't quite know what in that moment I was looking for. But when I got here to Longwood, yes, I was all hair and bell bottoms and tunics and sandals. And no, that was not popular then either. I was always my own person, if you will. But I was the first person in my family to attend college. And so for me, it was very important to do well, to do my very best, and to make a difference while I was here. While I was here, I probably read more than I ever had in my life to date. I wrote more papers than I could ever care to write in my life. But it wasn't until my senior year that I really started to understand that things like literary analysis and literary criticism was actually research in action. But what I was doing is I was answering other people's questions. And I realized that I still had questions of my own. So as I walked across the stage with my bachelor's degree, it was the first time that I thought, I might want to keep challenging myself. Because I realized then that research illuminates the path before you. You have to seek it, acknowledge it, take a breath, and then walk it. You'll never see the world beyond your feet unless you look up and out with insatiable curiosity. As an undergraduate, I didn't really see my path until I was practically upon it. I was thankful for strong mentors here at Longwood who recognized my potential and rather than stifling it, stoked it and watered the seeds we nurtured here. So I took root within a graduate experience. After a few years, I found myself back on campus for degree number two. This time it was for me. The first time, I was the first in my family to attend college. The second time, it was for me. I knew that I wanted more, and the coursework was more intense, the discussions were richer, the challenge was greater, but what impacted me most was my culminating experience. So I had the choice of taking the comprehensive exams or writing a master's thesis. And let's be honest, this chick is the worst test taker on the planet, so by default, I opted for the thesis. But what I thought I would do is research or pound out another form of literary analysis. My mentors were very persuasive and supportive, even though I fought it. I eventually caved, and what an experience it was for me. I conducted action research for my thesis. I had my first taste of real research, sort of the meat and potatoes, and I was hooked. I conducted a qualitative study that gave voice to struggling readers who were transitioning from middle school to high school. And my work mattered to me, and for the first time, I felt like it might matter to others. So even though research is tough, choose it anyway. The ability to consume, conduct, and analyze research will better prepare you for whatever lies ahead on your chosen path. My dad always says, if it was easy, anybody could do it. I could have taken the comps. I could have written a safe thesis. But I'm so glad I pushed myself. I took root as a researcher in those years, not knowing where my path would lead next. Well, my path. During my master's and the few years that followed, I was a middle school and then high school English teacher. I don't know, I feel like maybe that gives me some street cred here, right? So anyway, I came home one day and I opened my mailbox and I saw George Washington's sweet mug in my mailbox with the words, "Bring your ambition." And I thought, now that's one thing I've got. So thereafter, I was accepted to the George Washington University, as Dr. Porter mentioned earlier. And this is when research became everything. I realized as I sat amongst my peers and colleagues that those students who did opt for comps or never had the opportunity to write a master's thesis were not nearly as prepared for the research as I was. And I remember being very thankful in those moments for my upbringing here at Longwood, because that was a level of stress that I did not have, that many of my peers did. I toyed with research topics, second-guessing my research questions, until suddenly I noticed this amazing growth, that my mind was blooming in ways that I never knew that it could. I conducted a qualitative study illuminating the female's journey to the state superintendency. And in that research, I found my passion to promote female educational leadership in positive and nurturing ways. I was intrigued by females' pathways to leadership positions, and I was even more intrigued by those who indicated that other women were barriers to their success and growth. All too often, women tear each other down rather than lift each other up. Why? Perhaps research for another day. But what I did learn was that research is organic. Don't fight it. It will grow naturally if you let it. Start with a question, dig for knowledge, and reap personal and professional growth from the process. So sorry to go all Lorax on you, but seriously, trust in the process. Let it grow, enrich others, and the fruit that it will bear will be worth the work. Harvesting your fruit. For me, it was a lifelong charge. This is one of my first faculty photos, and I've never been more happy in my life than to be back here. After years of K-12 service, again, as mentioned in my bio, I pray that my path would lead me back here to this, my sacred ground. And after 15 years of scholarly gardening, I find myself back here, harvesting the fruits that I planted years ago as an undergraduate. And I must say, it's delish. I'm reminded daily that every seed planted matters, whether it's in the moments or in the years to come. So research matters to appreciate the past, to understand the present, and to prepare for the future. So in case you're wondering, this is the future. This is my son, William Reese, a Longwood legacy at heart. If you ask him where he's gonna go to college, he says Longwood. He wants to be a Lancer. And this is the future, and this is why it matters. And so today, I offer you a research challenge to flourish where you are, always. Beyond today, research your heart out for your yesterdays and for your tomorrows too. And also, I don't know if you can see the picture very clearly, but when I had my son here on campus, we took a photo with Joni on the stony. And so I encourage you to research purposefully, passionately, and perpetually. You never know who's watching. It could be your sibling, it could be your child, it could be Joni overlooking your shoulder, it could be Kai, let's face it, it could be Big Brother. It's important, make sure that what you do counts. Research what drives you, because if you don't, no one else will. And so with that, I must end in saying that I am thrilled to participate in this symposium with you. We have a full schedule of undergraduate and graduate presentations across campus. And this is my graduate plug. I encourage you to swing back by Greenwood later today, beginning at 2 for the graduate studies as well. And be sure to support your peers. I commend you for your hard work and your commitment to bettering yourself, your respective departments, and this fine university. Learn from one another today, and I look forward to learning from you. Have a groovy day of cultivating your own research fruit.
So what I would like to invite you to do now is, on your way out, should be a stack of brochures that has a kind of a brief overview schedule for the day. Enjoy the beautiful day that we're having as you can enjoy campus in the rain. If you head out from the library and go to your right, there's things going on in Bedford and in the CSTAC building right now, or not right this second, but at 9 o'clock. Start heading in that direction. If you go out and head in the other direction towards Blackwell and Ruffner, all of the oral presentations and poster sessions will start at 9. So I hope that you spend the day wandering campus. I know it's raining, but enjoy it and grab a snack on your way out and grab a brochure. The brochures have a code on them that you can scan with your cell phone if you're that sort of person who scans things with your cell phone, to find the detailed schedule if you're looking for a friend that's presenting at a certain time. And other than that, enjoy.
enjoy the day. Thank you.